Hello and welcome to this episode of Class Captures. This is your host, Jasper Sr. Today I'm going to do an introduction to the solar system and talk about parts of our solar system. So first of all, a solar system can refer to any star with objects considered non-star objects orbiting them. These can also be referred to as satellites or also bodies. Recently, with the advent of technology like the Hubble Space Telescope, we've learned that some solar systems may have two or three stars at the center. Ours only has one. The non-star objects in a solar system are held in orbit by gravity of the star or stars in the center. And we found evidence of numerous other solar systems. They're all very far away, but our understanding is growing that there are other solar systems besides our own. Generally speaking, though, when we talk about a solar system, we're talking about our own, with a sun and the eight planets that I'm going to describe in a few minutes. Now, in our particular solar system, over 99% of the mass and the matter is in the sun. All right, so it's this incredibly large, incredibly strong gravitational field at the center. Our sun, we think, is about 5 billion years old. It's an average star with average luminosity. And we think it's about halfway through its life cycle. And it's considered a main sequence star. Now, there's eight planets in our solar system, and they're inner planets and outer planets. We'll go more into detail in a future lesson on that. But there's three criteria for something to be considered a planet. The first is that it's generally spherical and smooth in shape. Second is that it travels in an orbit around a star, right? In our case, we're talking elliptical orbits. And the star we're talking about is the sun. And the third criteria is that they've cleared their orbits of all debris due to their gravity. And this is the criteria that Pluto does not meet, and that's the reason why it's no longer considered a planet. And all the planets have various tilts, rotation rates, and different characteristics such as atmospheric gases, temperatures, composition. They all have differences. That we'll discuss in a future lesson. Asteroids are smaller. They have an irregular shape. Since they're smaller, they have no atmosphere. And most of our solar system's asteroids are found in the asteroid belt, which is in between Mars and Jupiter. We think that when Jupiter formed, it has so much gravity itself that the Sun and Jupiter were kind of in this like giant tug of war, and the asteroids could have been another planet, but since they were not able to kind of clump together because of this tug of war between Jupiter and the Sun. And asteroids are from around 100 kilometers across to 1,000 kilometers across, so they can be fairly big, but nowhere near as big as a planet. This is an image of our moon. All right, and there's a little bit of a logical chain here. This is a body that orbits a planet, which is orbiting a star. So it's kind of a couple things need to be in place. I think it's cool the theory of how our moon, you know, a modern theory of how our moon formed, which was that when the Earth was molten, an asteroid hit and kind of splashed some molten material out that cooled, and as it was orbiting around Earth, cooled and formed into the moon. It's kind of a neat concept. Some planets have many moons, other planets have none. But the moon is pretty interesting. Our moon has no atmosphere, so any marks and craters and stuff will actually be undisturbed for a super long time. They have no weathering, no erosion, and no atmosphere on the moon. Comets are pretty neat. They're rare. They come around every once in a while. They have very ovalized orbits, and they go way out into space, and then they come back near the sun, and it takes a really long time for them to, you know, some comets we only see once. Others have a smaller orbit, so we'll see them every like Halley's Comet is, I think, every 76 years. But they're mostly water, and, you know, ice and methane, 1 to 100 kilometers in diameter. And they don't shoot across the sky like a shooting star. They would be in the sky one night, and then the next night they'd be a little bit farther along. So they move slowly to us. I mean, they're moving fast in the sky, in the actual, you know, them themselves are moving fast, but their apparent motion is slow. So you may see them for a couple weeks at a time before they disappear. And again, they're different than a shooting star. When they get close to the sun, they'll have two tails. One, as a result of their friction, they have a long tail going in the opposite the direction they're traveling. Then they'll have another tail that's going away from the sun. That's the sun energy evaporating that ice, which is kind of neat. So that only occurs when it's near the sun, though. Shooting stars are a little different. These are meteors, and these are when very small fragments come into our atmosphere. And these are all through the solar system. It's happening all the time. But they're fairly common. If you keep your eye to the sky, you'll see one in no time. Sometimes we go through a particular part of our orbit where there's more debris. And these are small, you know, sand size up to little rocks and pebbles. And so, like in August, there's a period where there's a meteor showers. November, so there's some different times of the year when there's more meteor showers. That's pretty cool to see. If they ever land on the ground, they're a meteorite. That's very rare because most of them burn up in the atmosphere. And this is again one of the benefits of the atmosphere, because the atmosphere helps protect us from these. Way out past the edge of the solar system is the Oort cloud. This is where we think comets originate. And these are small icy objects formed around dust grains. This really far out, 2,000 to 200,000 times farther than the Earth. It's measured in astronomical units. And this is one astronomical unit is the distance from the Earth to the sun. All right. So this is the Oort cloud. This is at the edge of, you know, what we would consider the outer edge of our solar system. And then you've got the Kuiper belt also, which is a second asteroid belt past Neptune out to 50 astronomical units. And this has a lot of objects. Kuiper belt objects over 100 kilometers across. They're more similar to Pluto than they are to planets or comets. All right, so they're unique, and we think that these are remains from when the solar system formed, objects that maybe weren't captured by the gravitational pull, or farther out. But this is the Kuiper belt as well. So thanks for watching this episode of Class Captures.